I will start. All right. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. My name is Yesir Bifad. I'm the Government Relations Advocacy Assistant at the Syrian American Council. We're based in Washington, D.C. We're a grassroots organization working to support the Syrian revolution. And I'm also a Syrian American activist. I was born and raised in the United States, but my family is originally from Homs, Syria. And I have just recently returned from a trip with several Syrian American activists from the liberated region of northern Syria. So first of all, I want to thank you all for tuning in and taking out the time of your day for joining us and being a part of this. And the goal, today's Google Hangout will focus on the role of social media in the Syrian revolution. So here's some background information. As we know, the Assad regime, since day one of the revolution, had limited or has not allowed entry for foreign journalists to come into Syria to document the uprising of in any way. If any journalists were allowed in, they snuck in and they risked their lives and it was illegal entrance. So essentially, the Assad regime has created a media blackout. So one of the ways to deal with this media blackout was this creation, or basically a role of the citizen journalist, where the Syrian people took it upon themselves to show the world what was going on in Syria. The main mediums was social media, such as Facebook, YouTube, Skype, and Twitter. So today we'll cover, amongst various topics, we'll cover which tools were used during the revolution, why they were used, their effect or their lack of effect, and we'll also go into depth of other topics as well. So we're honored to be joined today by several Syrian activists. Another one is unfortunately unable to join, but they have contributed greatly in documenting the Syrian revolution. I'm gonna start with introducing Osama. He's from the city of Kaframbal in Idlib, Syria. Kinan Rahmani is a Syrian-American activist and currently a law student who has also returned from the liberated regions of Syria. And we're joined by Delaney Chambers, who is a political communication master student at American University in Washington, D.C. She studied Arabic and political thought as an undergrad and was in Syria at the beginning of the Arab Spring. As a part of the Middle East Voices team at Voice of America, she carried out interviews with Syrian activists and civilians during the revolution. So first of all, the first question that I wanted to ask was, Osama, this is to you, I think. We know that the Assad regime kept a very close eye on activists in general before the revolution. You had to be very careful with what you said against the regime. You had to watch. And anything against the regime was not allowed. So there was obviously a big fear, and a part of this revolution was breaking that fear. How and when did you break this fear of using the social media as a tool of dissent against the Assad regime?
هلا في قبل مرحلة قبل الثورة كنا ما بعرف كيف بدك ترجم تحب أعطي أنا جمل أو شيء.
Okay, in the period starting from before the revolution.
كنت أنا لما أدخل على أي موقع سواء سكايب سواء فيسبوك سواء أي موقع تواصل.
You access any website or online service.
كنت أستخدم البروكسي نستخدم كسيرات البروكسي المعروفة يعني.
He used to use well-known proxies to access those services.
بسبب إنه طبعاً الموقع الفيسبوك كان محظور قبل الثورة. أنا كنت أستخدم بروكسي لحتى أقدر أدخل عليه مو بس لإجراءات أمنية.
Before the revolution, they had to use proxies just to access Facebook because it was blocked. So it wasn't just using proxies for security concerns, but it was just to be able to access the website via proxy.
بعد بداية الثورة الفيسبوك بالذات فتحوه وأنا استمريت في استخدام البروكسي.
After the revolution began, Facebook access was allowed, but he continued to use a proxy.
لأنه هذا الشيء كان أكثر أمانا بالنسبة لنا يعني.
Because it was important for improved security for them.
لأنه لما يعني نحن استغربنا إنه ليش فتحوا الفيسبوك بعد بداية الثورة يعني أكيد كان في مراقبة على التحصن يعني حتى من أصدقائنا.
They were surprised that Facebook was opened and access to Facebook was open after the revolution. And they assumed that it would be under heavy surveillance.
نعم. يعني بمرحلة ما قبل الثورة كان الاستخدام ضعيف مجرد التواصل مع بعض الأصدقاء فقط بحكم أنه الإنترنت يعني بطيء جدا.
Before the revolution they didn't really use the internet much because it was really slow.
لما بلشت الثورة بحكي بشكل عام ولا كمل على نفس المسار؟
لا لا كمل كمل.
طيب لما في بداية الثورة، أول ما بلشت الثورة بلش هون الاتصال يضعف، يعني صار في عندك السرعة نفسها بلشت تنقص، سرعة الإنترنت، تمام؟
When the revolution, as the revolution continued, the internet speed got slower.
صار في قطع، تقطع بالإنترنت، مرات يكون في
And they
إنترنت مرات
experienced
لا.
the disruption.
فهون بلشنا نستخدم أجهزة الإنترنت الفضائية في بداية الثورة، هي كان بداية استخدامنا لهي الأجهزة طبعا.
And so they started using satellite internet services, and that was the beginning of the revolution.
في البداية بالذات كنا نستخدم برنامج سكايب بحكم انه خصوصي على الموبايلات، تمام؟
They used to use Skype over the mobile phones.
لحتى بالذات ننقل الاخبار لاصدقائنا في الخارج، يعني كنا شبكة مجموعة اصدقاء عاملين جروب على سكايب، تمام؟
And the main purpose of doing that was that they could convey the realities of what was going on the ground, the news of the ground, to their contacts in the outside, and it was just a network of young activists that were doing that media distribution.
على في المرحلة اللي بعدها بلشنا نستخدم هون الفيسبوك لما اضطرينا يعني نعرف الناس على شغلنا أكثر، شو نحن، شو بنشتغل، ليش بلشت هاي الثورة، شو سبب بدايتها.
So as the revolution went on, they started to have a need to get the message of the revolution to a wider audience. So that's when they started using transition from using Skype with individual contacts to using Facebook with a wide audience.
ولاحقا طبعا اليوتيوب، لانه صار بدك تثبت، صارت وسائل الاعلام بالذات الاجنبيه الثقه صار بدها فيديو، صار الخبر بده ثقه اكبر، يعني الفيديو هو مثل ما بتعرف انت عامل ثقه اكبر لما حدا بيشوف فيديو.
And it became necessary in order to verify and confirm what was going on the ground. They learned and started using YouTube in order to record and create verified reports for the media and for the world.
So
sounds good. So you were saying with starting to use the social media and starting to use Facebook. Was there a very big fear? Were you afraid to use it as a medium, or at that point did you not care anymore?
بالنسبة إلي ما كنت خاف قبل الثورة حتى وبعدها، بس لأنه كنت أنا أعرف أحمي حالي بالضبط، يعني عندي شوية معلومات كمان.
For him personally, he wasn't afraid neither before the revolution nor during the revolution. He was well informed about how to conduct himself online and knew how to protect himself.
أما بالنسبة لأصدقائي كان في مشكلة، لأنه في إعدادات داخل مواقع التواصل الاجتماعي، الإعدادات ما كانوا يعرفوا يظبطوها، كنت يعني أنا أشرح لهم أغلب الأحيان عنها يعني.
A lot of his friends had problems, and he helped them so that they could access these websites securely.
يعني اللي يترك حسابه مفتوح، يعني بعض الأشخاص أصدقائنا يعني تعرضوا للاعتقال بسبب بعض الكتابات لهم على الفيسبوك يعني بالذات يعني.
Many of his friends were subjected to detainment and detention because they were the government had surveillance on their accounts, and as a result of that, they were detained.
بس بشكل عام طبعا هي نحن الخوف اللي كنا عايشينه اكيد يعني اكيد موجود ضمن بيئه ضمن مواقع التواصل الاجتماعي، كونه نحن عم نعيشه على ارض الواقع فاكيد بدنا نعيشه بمواقع التواصل الاجتماعي، يعني الخوف العام يعني.
They had a lot of fear just as a component of their public life and as a result of the revolution. And that same fear was in the reality and as well in the virtual online world.
يعني في مرحلة ما قبل الثورة انتقاد الشخص الرئيس أو أي تصرف له يعني هو بمثابة خيانة للبلد، بتعتبره الحكومة عندنا خيانة للبلد. فما بالك انه تنشر هذا النوع من الانتقاد لسه صفة خيانة مزدوجة.
just saying or criticizing the president of Syria was considered treason in Syria since before the revolution, and of course to this day. So it was even greater level of treason to be publishing those criticisms of the president of Syria.
فالوضع كان يعني كتير أي كلمة نحكيها يعني بدك تحسب لها ألف حساب. يعني أنا كنت أحكي ممكن, فحتى في كتير من أصدقائي يعني ما يتفاعلوا مع أي شيء أنا أحكي بسبب الخوف إنه يحكوا معي لاحقا إنه يعني أسامة خفف شوي, لا تحكي رأيك بصراحة, تعرف أنت يعني.
Everyone that wanted to criticize the regime needed to think about it several times before they did it because of the high level of fear and the high consequences that they would face. And so Osama, from in the very beginning, his friends would come to him and they would say, take it easy, don't be as critical of the regime because this is going to cause problems.
هلا في إذا بدي أكمل على مرحلة بداية الثورة, بكفرنبيل بالذات مجموعة شباب عملنا جروب على سكايب, جروب صغير لنقل الأخبار. كان ما زال في تغطية عنا, تغطية خليوي وإنترنت, تمام.
They created a group and a network on Skype for the news when they had internet service.
في البداية كنا نستخدمه لحتى طبعا كنا داخلين عليه مجموعة أشخاص تقريبا 15 إلى 20 شخص, عنا ثقة في بعضنا, بنعرف بعضنا على أرض الواقع, فأي شخص بينشر أي خبر هو بالذات شخص ثقة, معروف مين اللي أنتج هالخبر وتفاصيل الخبر بتكون مكتوبة موثقة يعني.
So they originally started with a Skype group of around 15 to 20 activists who all knew each other in person. So all of their reports were trusted between one another. And when any one of them would post something, they would all read it and know that what was going on the ground.
بنفس الوقت كان هالغرفة هي نفسها لها تواصل مع المجموعات اللي أكبر منها, اللي كانت مثل الشبكات الإخبارية اللي لاحقا صارت. كان لنا تواصل معهم اللي هنو لهم علاقاتهم مع الميديا اللي هي مثل ما تعرف القنوات الفضائية والنيوز بيبرز و something like that. No.
And at the same time, this small network that they had locally was sharing information with the larger networks that were running throughout Syria, and those larger networks would convey the news that was going on locally in their town to foreign media and other journalists.
بتذكر أنا في بداية الثورة لما بعد ما صار في تهديد مباشر وهربنا قسم كبير من الأشخاص من المدينة بحكم وجود الجيش فيها.
He's remembering ممكن تعيد الفكرة؟
في بداية الثورة لما في بداية دخول الجيش على مدينة كفرنبيل.
Yeah, in the beginning when the regime forces entered the town of Kafranbil where he's from.
معظم الأشخاص اللي كانوا يطلعوا بالمظاهرات هربوا خارج المدينة وأنا واحد منهم.
The majority of the people who used to go and protest outside of the city.
فهون طبعاً برزت أهمية التواصل, فصار الكل يجي بده يتعلم على شيء اسمه سكايب, على شيء اسمه فيسبوك. يعني تعرضنا لضغط كبير هون في هالفترة هاي بالذات, إنه أغلب الشباب, في كتير شباب شاركوا اللي كانوا مشاركين معنا بالثورة خبرتهم ضعيفة بمواقع التواصل الاجتماعي.
So I mean, in the process of having to go and do those protests outside the city, there became a very important need for people to be able to communicate online, and there were a lot of people who didn't know how to do that. So they were all sort of asking and trying to learn from one another on how to use Skype and Facebook and these other communication platforms.
ايوه بالضبط. فحاولنا كتير يعني عملنا كتير ورشات, عملنا نعرف الناس انه هذا سكايب له استخدام, 1 2 3 4, الفيسبوك كيف تستخدمه, لاحقا اليوتيوب, تمام. فتعرضنا لضغط كبير لانه مثل ما قلت لك معظم هون كان عندهم جهل بهذا الموضوع انه الانترنت. فلما بلش ينعرض شيء او بلش ينتج تشوف شيء مثلا مقطع مظاهرة صورة لافتة لك على الميديا, هون ظهر التأثير، حسوا بالتأثير صاروا يطلبوا منك تساعدهم.
They were under a lot of pressure to do workshops and give people very detailed instructions on to how to use these different services because there was a lot of ignorance in with the they weren't well educated with how to use Facebook and Skype and these other services. They had never really had a need to use them, but people would, after the protest, would see clips of their protest online, and that would really inspire them to want to share their stuff and to learn how to use these tools.
وبالذات انه تخيل انه شخص يسألك انه شو هو سكايب او شو هو الفيسبوك، يعني بدك تجاوبه يعني من ما بيعرف شيء ابدا يعني.
It was at the point where people would ask, like, what is Skype, what is Facebook? They had never even heard of these technologies before. So you have to explain everything to them from A to Z.
Okay, sir.
Okay. What was the role of social media and these Facebook groups to organize protests or to organize strikes? Did you use it to organize times and locations? To what extent?
ممكن ترجم كنان بالضبط.
كيف كنتوا تستخدموا الفيسبوك والمواقع للاتصال الجمعية؟ كيف كنتوا تستخدموها لتنظموا المظاهرات وال شو اسمه الاعتصام الاعتصام؟
أجابي أوكي.
يعني كنتوا تستعملون تحددوا الأوقات في هون المواقع المحلات يعني كل
تمام فهمت علي. هلا نحن بالأخص مدينة كفرنبي المدينة ليست يعني بطبيعتها هي أقرب للريف من المدينة. تمام.
So Kaframbi is closer to the it's more in the suburbs than it is in the city.
يعني بطبيعتنا نحن أشخاص اجتماعيين على أرض الواقع. تمام.
So they're naturally a socially integrated group.
فلذلك في بداية الثورة كان الاستخدام الأكبر أي ممكن في بداية الثورة. في بداية الثورة كنا نستخدم مواقع التواصل الاجتماعي أكثر من الفترة اللي بعدها. أنا عم بحكي بين بعض مو بيننا وبين الخارج. تمام.
So in the beginning they used to use these websites more between themselves to organize protests.
خصوصي إنه في بداية الثورة
So they used to use a combination of both Facebook and Skype in order to coordinate the location and time of their protests.
No. لاحقا طبعا اليوتيوب يعني اغلب الناس ما بيعرفوا اليوتيوب ابدا، يمكن عندنا بالذات في مرحلة ما قبل الثورة بيعرفوا على انه موقع بشكل عام انه للفيديو. تمام.
So YouTube specifically, people didn't really know what the use or how to use the YouTube, but they knew that in general it was a site for video.
لا ما حدا متعود يرفع مقطع فيديو لأنه أصلاً السرعة ما بتسمح في هذا الشيء.
No one had ever been had the need or had ever uploaded a video onto YouTube because they had such slow internet that it wasn't practical to do that.
بس ولكن من بداية من أول مظاهرة حصلت بكفرنبيل تم تصويرها ورفعها على اليوتيوب. ولما شافوها الناس على القنوات الفضائية للمظاهرة.
Since the very first protest that happened in Kaframbe, that first protest was uploaded onto YouTube and then it got put onto international media. And when people saw that,
لما شافوا الناس المظاهرة سألوا كيف يعني كيف وصلت هاي المظاهرة لهاي الميديا. فعن طريق اليوتيوب هون أدركوا أهمية إنه أهمية هالمواقع هاي بالذات، يعني أهمية الفيسبوك أو اليوتيوب أو حتى سكايب نفسه. يعني
when people saw their protest on TV, they asked themselves, how is it possible that our protest, and we know that there's no media allowed here. How is it possible that that protest ended up online? And when they made that connection, they realized how important YouTube is.
طبعا هي المواقع ساعدتنا كثير يعني بشكل كثير في ايصال الفكره يعني نحن بكفرن بالذات يعني بدون هاي المواقع يمكن ما كان حدا عرفنا او ما كان حدا شافنا لانه نحن عباره عن قريه صغيره في مكان بعيد يعني اكيد اللي ساعدنا على الانتشار هو فوق انه نحن عم ننتج شيء بجوز يكون شيء عم يعبر عن شيء عم يعبر عن تاريخ تمام المواقع هاي ساعدتنا ايضا في الانتشار لانه حاليا اللافته اللي عم تطلع عم تشوفها ثلاث ارباع الدنيا على الفيسبوك على التويتر على السكايب تمام
So he was saying that the social media websites were critical in order for them to get their message out, especially for their town of Kreframbil, which is really it's a small town. Most people haven't even heard of it, but because they were able to use social media and because the protests that they were doing were of a highly expressive and creative and unique nature, people really connected with them because they were expressing a very unique message and history of their town and of the revolution was being expressed very uniquely. And so that caused their protests and their slogans and their posters and drawings to become viral on the internet, and millions of people were seeing the posters that they were creating.
Okay, sir. It's clear or you want to
Sounds
ask?
Good. Kenan, this question is for you now. You're a Syrian American, so you're on the other side of the world, where you are the receiver of the news that activists like Usama are pumping out to the world. Were these videos and these accounts your main source of media for Syria, or did you still try to rely on traditional news outlets despite the fact that they limited? And how receptive were you to these accounts from these activists that were sending things out to you?
So first of all, I want to say that everything that we did in our role as Syrian American activists and activists outside of Syria relied 100% on what the activists inside were doing. Nothing that we were doing could have ever been done if it wasn't for the efforts that they were going through and their incredible bravery and sacrifice. And that became evident really quickly because most of the traditional media was not able to have effective publishing or convey what was going on the ground. They too were relying on the activists, but they were doing so with less context in comparison to the activists like me and others who were working outside of Syria, who were talking to activists basically 24 hours a day and had much more context than a lot of the traditional news that was trying to keep up with the revolution. There are a lot of cases where the traditional news got it wrong. There were reports that were reported by major news sources that were all proven to be wrong. And a lot of those reports we knew from the beginning that activists were telling us, this report is wrong, don't spread it. And they were right. And when we would get a report and it wouldn't be verified by several independent sources of activists, we wouldn't share those reports because we had guidelines as to what was verified and what was legitimate news and what wasn't. So when we would get sort of several independent activists confirming the same thing, that's when we would know that it was true, and in almost all cases, those reports were true, and they were always more accurate than the traditional news. The activists, civilian activists in Syria, are the real heroes when it comes to getting the message of what was going on in Syria out, because the traditional news was not able to really deal with the situation accurately.
Great. All right, Delaney, also this question goes to you really quickly. As a student of political communication, give us some of your insight as to how you see that the role of social media has controlled or not controlled the narrative or the political dynamics and the political narrative of the Syrian revolution. Do you have any insight into that, or let us know.
I do. I think that as the others were saying, the narrative of the Syrian revolution wouldn't be the same without activist contributions, and obviously without the verification of some of the information coming out of Syria, it wouldn't be the same. But at the same time, I kind of wonder, because as you were saying, that Kenan, the mainstream media often gets the story wrong, or they kind of produce information that's not, that hasn't been verified or that's not verifiable. And I think that was the case even from the beginning of the revolution, for example, when I was in Syria. So if political figures, for example, the UN Security Council, who actually has power to legislate on what's going on in Syria, if they are getting misleading information, then it might be more difficult for them to make the right decisions, the decisions that are best, you know, for Syria and for the rest of the world, for stability in terms of the rest of the world. So I think that the lack of verifiable information could be a problem in that case, and it has been a problem.
Especially. So you think in that regard, then, you know, the role of the citizen journalist, although it is a source, can, you know, it's not like you, I think maybe the strong enough kind of source in order to kind of push political movement or international movement, or do you think you know, there's only to a certain extent that it can be taken? What is your insight into that?
Right. Well, I think the role of the citizen journalist is a very important one, because obviously that's the information that we're actually sure of. Like, if we get information from Syria provided by citizen journalists, then you know where it's coming from, and you know that it's accurate, especially if it's verified by several independent sources, as Kenan was saying. So that information is reliable, but as you were saying, not prevalent enough,
right,
and not represented by mainstream media sources, especially in countries like America, where once mainstream media picks up on a narrative and runs with it, there's no sometimes it just kind of feeds on itself and not on the information that's actually coming out of Syria, especially since it was so difficult for journalists, like correspondents, et cetera, to get access to Syria. So the reporting has been very spotty, and yeah, I think that's been difficult. Maybe not because there's not enough citizen journal, but maybe because it's not as organized as it could be, or as prevalent as it could be, or also because mainstream media doesn't go through the same verification process that Kenan does. Does that make sense?
Yeah, definitely. Okay, so I think we can transition then, because we were talking about, you know, how relevant or how prevalent the role of citizen journalists is to, you know, the political dynamics of the international community. To this question for you, Usama, is that, you know, as activists and, you know, you've been pushing videos and accounts using Facebook and YouTube, and you're trying to let the world know what's going on in Syria from day one, in hopes for something to happen, or in hopes for something to change. Well, first of all, were you doing it in hopes of something to change, or were you just doing it, what was the intention first and foremost behind pushing everything to let the world know? And then I have a follow-up question to that.
في البداية احنا وجدنا كأشخاص كناشطين على الأرض وجدنا نفسنا مضطرين نشتغل كصحفيين. تمام؟ كنان؟
Yeah, in the beginning, they, as individuals and as activists, they found themselves having to fulfill the role of journalists.
طبعاً نحن ما عندنا أي خبرة بالعمل الصحفي. نحن شباب. أنا ممكن مهندس. في شاب ممكن يكون عامل. شاب ممكن يكون صيدلاني. من كافة الفئات يعني. تمام.
And they have no prior experience in journalism. Osama is an engineer. His friend is a pharmacist. And they have activists who are from all different fields.
ففجأة طبعاً الوضع في كتير شغلات عم تصير وأنت المصدر بتحس حالك إنه أنت المصدر الوحيد للخبر لأنه الدولة والحكومة السورية منعت دخول وسائل الإعلام لتغطي الأحداث اللي عم تصير بالبلد.
And suddenly they found themselves to be the only source for news because the Syrian regime had denied access for independent journalists to access these events.
طبعا الصحفيين اللي دخلوا لعنا دخلوا، خصوصا على كفرنبي اللي دخلوا مجموعة صحفيين أجانب، ولكن عدد قليل ولفترة محدودة. بتضل أنت بالمقابل، يعني الخبر راح تضل أنت المصدر تبعه، إنه بينزلوا لفترة فقط، فترة بسيطة، بيشوفوا جزئية، ما بيشوفوا المشهد كامل.
So, despite the stricter role of the regime of denying journalists, some journalists were able to come to Kaframbid, but it was a very limited number of journalists who were only able to stay for a very short amount of time. So, despite having some journalists who were able to spend a little bit of time in the town, they still found themselves to be the only source that could be consistent and they're available all the time.
هلا بالنسبة لموضوع التأثير، تأثير الشيء التغطية أو التغطية اللي عم نقوم فيها للأحداث اللي عم تصير، تأثيرها على السياسات الدولية، على السياسة العالمية. هلا شخصيا أنا الحكومات بعتقد تشتغل على مبدأ المصالح أكثر من مبادئ أخرى يعني.
So with regards to how their work inspired or changed the political scope of a political scene of the international community, the political decisions that were being taken, he didn't really he wasn't really convinced that the governments relied on principles or the reality when it comes to how to deal with the situation, and rather governments rely on their own self-interest and political interests in deciding these sorts of things.
فالفكرة كانت انه نحن نوصل في البداية، وهي كان الجروب اللي معي بالذات، نحن انه نوصل فكرتنا للشعوب اكثر منها للحكومات، لانه الحكومات ما كانت، يعني الحكومات تملك قوة تأثير ولكنها يعني ما كانت تتحرك ساكن، بينما الشعوب اذا وصلت لها ممكن تضغط على الحكومات تبعها.
So for Osama and the other activists that were in his group, their objective was really more to reach the populations of the of foreign countries rather than the governments, because even though the governments are the ones that have the executive and legislative control, it was the people that they were trying to reach who could then pressure their governments to take action.
طبعا التوثيق هو اهم جزء في العمل، يعني بالذات موضوع الاخباري، موضوع التغطية الصحفية، يعني انه لما بيصير اي حدث بدك توثق انه صار في اعتقال، بدك تعطي الاسم، صار في شهيد مثلا بدك تعطي اسمه، الثلاثي، التاريخ، التفاصيل، يعني اهم شيء التفاصيل، لانه بدون تفاصيل صفت اشاعه مو خبر.
So with regards to journalism and working with I mean human rights groups, they found that the most important thing was verifying the news that they were getting on the ground. So when someone would be detained, they would be have the name of the person who is detained. When someone would be killed, they would have the first, middle, last name, date of birth, where the person was killed, because that was really the only way to create verified news that could be trusted by the media, and that would establish a standard of journalistic sort of independence and integrity for these journalists, civilian journalists that had been working.
موضوع التأثير أظن أنه نحن بشكل عام لما بلشنا نخاطب العالم باللغة الإنجليزية، يمكن هذا أهم شغلة نجحنا فيها، لما بلشنا نرسم ونشتغل يعني على شيء انترناشونال مثل ما بيقولوا، يعني لغة إنجليزية، لافتات باللغة الإنجليزية زائد رسومات، هذا الشيء بلش يوصل فكرتنا، بلش العالم يحس انه نحن في عنا شيء، في عنا مطالب، في هون حدا في هون حدا في ثورة بالبلد، مو صراع مسلح. تمام.
So they found that in order to have their message reach people and to be able to sort of inspire people to think about the revolution in the way that they wanted the message to reach, they found that drawings and slogans in English and banners in English, that was the way to get their message to reach an international audience. And and that really was how they let the narrative that, look, you guys, Earth, the people of the world, humanity, there's a revolution here. it's not armed conflict between rebel factions, but this is actually a people that we have specific demands and a specific message, and this is a revolution for our freedom.
يعني لما بنكون سهرانين وبعم نختار مثلا موضوع اللافتي او موضوع الرسم الكاريكاتير اللي بدنا نرسمه اللي انا بعرف انه تاني نهار رح ينتشر بشكل كبير خصوصا على مواقع التواصل الاجتماعي يعني بحس بمسؤوليه كبيره تمام انه في يعني انا ما بعرف كيف اعبر عنها حتى بالعربي يعني انه حس انه لازم وصل انا بدي احاول اوصل للشعب الحكومات انا مليت من الخطاب تبعها مليت من انه الفكره تبعي وصلت للحكومات الحكومات ما بتتخذ اي شيء فانا بدي خاطب الشعب تمام.
So when they would be the night before a protest, they would be gathered together at night to make the slogans and make the drawings for the following day's protest. He would feel a tremendous sort of burden and responsibility to get exactly the right message because he became aware that his drawings were the mechanism, the vehicle for people of the world to know the reality of what's going on in Syria. And he got sick of governments and political speeches and statements. What he was focused on was using his drawings and the drawings of the youth and activists that he was with, for them to use their drawings and to use their language to be able to get the message to the people in other countries.
Mm. Okay.
All right. So, I mean, you said, just a follow-up question is, you know, you're getting your message across, and you have, you know, these posters that are in English, and they're being spread on the internet and to the news outlets, yet nothing is changing in the international community. Do you feel a frustration, or is this just, where does that frustration come in, and what keeps you going to make sure that your message is still told through social media, through these YouTube videos, and through Facebook?
كنان بس اخذ جزء
يعني هل يعني صار عندكم احباط من انه انتم عم كل اسبوع عم تطلعوا مظاهرات وعم توصلوا الرساله تبعكم للشعوب وللحكماء ولكن هن يعني ما عم بيتصرفوا مع يعني المجتمع الدولي ما عم بيساوي شيء؟
الاحباط بالمعنى الجزئي مبيس يعني شوي تمام. نحن سنتين بنطلع بالمظاهرات سنتين بنعبر عن رأينا. مطالبنا كانت واضحة من البداية بدنا شوية حرية يعني حتى ما بدنا كثير كانت بالبداية يعني طبيعي يعني أنا فيك ترجيم حتى أكمل.
He's saying that frustration, they felt a lot of frustration. I mean, they went out for 2 years and protested and were being killed just to be able to protest. And all they wanted was a little bit of freedom. They didn't even want all freedoms. They just wanted a little bit more freedom. And in general, the international community didn't do anything.
بالذات انه بتذكر المظاهرات اللي كنا نطلع في البداية كان في حماس عالي كان في يعني الصوت يطلع من القلب بينما حاليا تشعر بالملل سنتين كل اسبوع انت عم تطلع مرتين وثلاثه بتتظاهر بتخبر العالم انه انت مطالبك 1 2 3 بترجع بتكرر بطريقه مختلفه استنفذنا كل الطرق بس لنوصل افكارنا للاخرين انه نحن مطالبنا هي على الشكل التالي ساعدونا مثلا باي شكل من الاشكال ومع ذلك ما عم نشوف غير الصواريخ نظام الأسد فقط والنيران تبعه ونحن طبعا مستمرين بس بكون عم بكذب عليك إذا بقلك بنفس النفس أكيد الإنسان بمل وبيتعب بس نحن إن شاء الله ما رح نيأس.
He's saying that in the beginning they were very excited and they were going out with a lot of enthusiasm and excitement to the protest. They would go, they would protest 1, 2, 3 times a week. Sometimes they would protest every day of the week. And they just wanted to get their message out to the world. And after 2 years of doing that, they became exhausted, they became bored, and all they're seeing is the rockets and bombs of the Assad regime, and no one is really doing anything. So it would be unreasonable for people not to feel a great degree of frustration and to feel that their efforts are futile. But despite that, they are going to persevere until the regime is overthrown.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Delaney, do you have anything to add to this idea of to this past few the questions that we've been asking?
Actually, a follow-up question. Kenan, maybe you can answer this. If there clearly hasn't been, they've kind of come to a standstill on the international stage in terms of changing anything in Syria. So what do you think needs to happen? Do you think that it's more of these demonstrations, or do you think that these like political diplomatic talks that Osama has disregarded are going to eventually be the solution? Because Russia has said that they're now willing to discuss the issue. So what do you think needs to happen, and do you think that anything will change the mind of the international community?
I mean, I think the people of Syria, actually, despite them being disengaged from politics for most of the past half century, I think they've got pretty active. The international community is interested mostly in securing their own political and economic interests. And short of the Free Syrian Army and other groups that are defending the freedom of Syrians causing serious losses to the Assad regime, I think that the international community will continue to stall as long as they can until they can sort of enforce a solution on their grounds. But as a parallel to that, the work of civilians is critical for several reasons. First of all, the military narrative, the Free Syrian Army alone, loses most of the principles of what this revolution was about, which is what the civilians like Osama and others, they go out week after week, even after most of the revolution is being handled by armed forces. They are the ones that continue to control the message, all right? And even when it comes to the Free Syrian Army and the civilian activists, the two separate narratives, the military narrative, it's well known in Syria that we want a civilian civil society, and we're not gonna suddenly move to another military dictatorship. So mm-hmm. even in areas where they're liberated and that they're under basically the protection and they're being served by the Free Syrian Army to protect them, it's the activists like Osama who have formed civilian councils, who manage the administration of basic services to the country, and they still, despite the Free Syrian Army being a necessary component for protecting them, they're the ones that govern these areas, and areas which have been governed by the Free Syrian Army have not succeeded in the way that Syrians started this revolution for. So it's really, both parts are critical. But when it comes to what's going to change the international community, I don't think that the international community is going to be able to come up with solutions that are acceptable to the people of Syria who have sacrificed for 2 years, and it's also acceptable to their own self-interests. One side or the other is going to win, and I am confident that the people who have sacrificed, the tens of thousands, they're the ones that are going to be victorious over the Assad regime and over any other government that wants to impose its own kind of solution on Syria.
Omar, what role do you think media will have to play in this eventual transition?
Yeah, you're breaking up.
Osama, sorry.
It's okay, Delaney, but you're breaking up for me.
Okay. Osama?
Uh-huh. Yeah, can you ask your question again?
What role do you think social media... Yeah, can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
Sorry, okay. What role do you think social media will have to play in the transition?
كيران ممكن ترجم لي؟
شو هو الدور اللي بتتوقع المواقع الاجتماعية ممكن تلعبها يعني بالانتقال من النظام الحالي يعني للمستقبل؟
Can I really quickly just jump in here? For example, Delaney, actually, I was going to follow up with a question on that. For example, Osama, we saw a video of you circulating on YouTube talking about the civilian council that you're running and the constitution of your city. I mean, that's not covering the revolution anymore. It's looking towards the future. So we saw that. And so do you see this playing a big role in order to educate and to kind of help with this transition?
كمان كنان ترجم لي.
هي عم تقول انه في الفيديو يلي نشرتوه من كفرنبيل عن الدور تبع المجالس الإدارية المدنية. وعم تسأل انه شو هو الدور للمواقع على الانترنت الاجتماعية لحتى تثقف الناس وتعلم الناس بالجهد يعني بالمجتمع
المدني.
فهمت علي؟ تفضل. المجتمع المدني.
هلا الدور كتير كبير لأنه أول شيء إن العالم كله عم ينظرنا من خلال هاي المواقع، يعني من خلال مواقع التواصل الاجتماعي العالم بحكم عدم وجود تغطية صحفية أو أي شيء ممكن نسموه مستقل، ما في تغطية صحفية أو تغطية إخبارية للداخل السوري، فالعالم عم ينظرنا من خلال هاي المواقع من خلال الشيء.
Social media is critical and is going to continue to play a huge role because it's through these social networking sites that they are able to get their messages out to everyone in the world because they don't have any kind of independent media and that's really their only vehicle for their message.
هلا نحن عم نحاول نكون يعني قدر الامكان موضوعيين في تغطيتنا للاخبار سواء او للشيء اللي عم يصير عندنا مثل تشكيل مجلس محلي مثل تشكيل عندنا مكتب مالي عندنا مكتب احصاء عندنا يعني نحن عندنا تقريبا فيك تقول عندنا نحن قادرين على اداره المرحله المقبله باذن الله بس طبعا نحن لازم نفهم الاخرين انه الشيء الموجود عندنا تمام.
He's saying that I forgot what he said. He said that they have, I mean, they're already using these sites because they need to get the message out about the transitional roles that they're doing. They have a civilian government, they have a sort of a treasury, they have an office that deals with compiling statistics and documenting and I can't.
طيب هاي المجلس المحلي سواء او المجالس تشكلت المكاتب اللي عم تشتغل حاليا كلها لها صفحات على المواقع الاجتماعية وعم تعرض العمل تبعها منشان بس اوكي.
All of these offices that he mentioned in the civilian councils, all of the work that they're doing is being published and shared on social networks.
طبعا العالم عم يشاهدنا من خلال هاي المواقع. بالإضافة لهاي المواقع نحن كتير بيزورونا صحفيين مثل ما حكينا بيتأكدوا من حقيقة هالشيء من وجود من نحن ممكن إذا قلنا في مجلس محلي في ناس عم تنزل تشوف هذا المجلس عم ياخذ قرارات عم تتنفذ تمام.
So they have everything they're doing they're sharing on social networks and there are people who are coming to verify they're coming to their towns and they're verifying that in fact this civilian council is doing what it's saying it's doing.
فنحن عن طريق هاي المواقع عم نبني جسر ثقة يعني عم نفهم الآخرين إنه نحن شو عم نشتغل نحن عنا سيطرة مدنية على الجهة العسكرية مثلا يعني ككفرنبيل في عنا المجلس المحلي هو بيتخذ القرارات اللي بتسري او بنفذها حتى الفريسيان ارمي يعني الجيش الحر نفسه تمام.
So they're using these social networks to establish their legitimacy and their credibility, and to prove, even for example in their town, Kafrembe, that it's the civilian structures that actually dominate and control the town, and the Free Syrian Army is actually subject to and serves the civilian structures of their town.
ونحن بالذات حاولنا نبرز هذا الموضوع دائما في الإعلام تبعنا في مواقعنا في مواقع التواصل الاجتماعي كلها أنه نحن بدنا دولة مدنية كل شيء ديكتاتوري حكم الفرد الواحد خلاص انتهى
and they have been using social media in order to continually remind the world and reinforce through their message that they are there to build a civil society and not another not accept another military authoritarian government.
Okay.
Great. I think that is all that we have for all the time that we have for today. But I wanted to thank you all for joining us, and definitely I think we saw that social media kind of was a big force behind, you know, the organization and then letting the world know. It was a disappointment at times because, or not in and of itself as a medium, but the lack of kind of effect that we had, as Delaney had mentioned, that the political community couldn't necessarily respond based off of these accounts of the citizen journalists. So at a time we saw that it was a frustration, but it was needed to continue. For the Syrian people, so that the people around the world knew, so that the Syrian people can mobilize the people around the world to put pressure on their government. And then finally, we see that social media has a big kind of role to play in the future. As these civilian councils are being formed, you know, it's going to be used as Osama has mentioned, as a tool for education, a tool for communication between different civilian councils, because this period coming up post Assad, hopefully soon, you know, it's going to need some stability, and whatever mediums that are going to help enforce that stability will be key. So Osama, thank you. Shukran kteer a waqtak. Thank you for your time. Delaney, thanks for joining. And
thanks for having me.
Appreciate your insight. And Kinan, thank you for translation and your insight.
Thanks for having me.
All right.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks very much.
Bye.
Okay. Bye-bye.